Welcome to Evangelistic Outreach Ministries.
The fields are white, all ready to harvest.
For over half a century, the Evangelistic Outreach team has traveled across the street, about the nation, and around the world with the gospel message. We're dedicated to the vision of our late founder, Dr. Calvin Evans, to reach the unreached for Jesus Christ. May the love of Christ touch you, and may His Word teach you, today on Evangelistic Outreach.
Today on Evangelistic Outreach Ministries, we're going to be going to a sermon out of the series of messages that we've been featuring on this month's gift offer entitled Unusual from Calvin Ray Evans. And we hope it'll be a challenge and a blessing to you from the Word of God. We'll tell you more about the details of that gift offer here in just a little bit, but please join us in prayer today. Heavenly Father, we thank You for the opportunity we have each week to come on this broadcast and for nearly 30 minutes share the good news of Jesus Christ through song and through preached word. Lord, we know that the singing sets the table for the Word of God, for without the Word of God, there's no salvation, there's no victory, there's no authority in anything other than the Word of God. And we're so thankful for the privilege that we have, the gift that You've allowed us to share with so many that need Your help. We know there are going to be people watching today that need just a variety of miracles in their life. People that need salvation, people that need healing, people need a financial miracle, a breakthrough in their life, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. And we're so thankful that at Your name, all those needs can be met. And so, Jesus, we pray today that You would perform a miracle. And Lord, we'll praise You and thank You for what You're going to do. In Your precious name we pray. Amen.
Some are known by great authority, for kingdoms as far as eyes can see. In royal robes they rule from thrones, waging wars they overthrow the weak and call it victory. My King is known by mercy. My King is known by grace. For the hope in His name and the power that saves. My King is known by the cross. My King is known by an empty grave. Oh, in all that He does, my King is known by love.
I can almost see Him even now, rejected with thorns upon His brow. What kind of king would leave His throne to make my sin and shame His own? Yet He gave His life for me. He gave His life for me.
My King is known by mercy. My King is known by grace. For the hope in His name and the power that saves. My King is known by the cross. My King is known by an empty grave. Oh, in all that He does, my King is known
'Cause my King is known by mercy. And my King is known by grace.
For the hope in His name and the power that saves. My King is known by the cross.
Here in the month of August, we have a spectacular gift offer that we'd like to share with you. It's entitled Unusual. And Calvin Ray, throughout the spring and summer, has been sharing some tremendous messages in this series of messages titled Unusual. And in that, he deals with unusual people, unusual passages, and unusual phrases, all out of the Word of God. And so on this month's gift offer, we're sharing with you sermons from three different locations, from the Smoky Mountain Camp Meeting, the Community Bible Church, and also the Rubyville Community Church, where he's been sharing these powerful messages. And again, these are messages that you don't hear a lot from on these particular phrases or passages or people. It doesn't mean that they haven't been preached before. It just means that they haven't been dealt with a lot. And so Calvin Ray chooses to use this series of messages to actually open the Bible to us in such a unique and powerful way. You will not be disappointed if you order this month's free gift offer, available on DVD or audio CD. And again, as always, you can visit our YouTube channel at Evangelistic Outreach Ministries, and you can watch the services on demand there when you search for the August free gift offer on Evangelistic Outreach Ministries YouTube channel. And please do me a favor. We've been asking you to do this for the last few months, and we encourage you to do so. If you are on YouTube, we ask that you would subscribe to our YouTube channel. Hit that notification bell. That'll let you know whenever we upload new programs weekly, and then also special features and events that we will be advertising on our YouTube channel. That'll notify you on your smart device or on your computer or your television. It's a great way to stay up to date with this ministry and what we are doing locally and in your area. So visit our website at calvinevans.org for more information there. Of course, you can always write to us and request a gift offer at 299 Ohio Avenue, New Boston, Ohio, 45652. And again, call our office if you need any more help with this gift offer, as well as upcoming meetings in the near future. 800-767-8713. Well, let's get back into the series of messages entitled Unusual from Calvin Ray Evans.
In 1977, I was called to preach. 1978, I went to that same little church that Dad had been to hold a revival. God sent a revival. We were scheduled about three nights. I forget how many weeks the revival went on, but night after night, people were coming, being saved. I don't think there was a night of the revival until the night we closed the revival out. That was the only night that someone wasn't saved. That wasn't to do with me. That's because God's people prayed and believed God. It was all to do with God. But they were being saved. And on that last night of revival, there was a man that showed up that I knew immediately. You know how it is, Mike. You've been in these churches enough. You know immediately God's done something big just when they walk through the door. Kind of like a fellow told me at the funeral today. He said, I want to come to church, but I'm afraid the roof will fall in. I said, well, come on. And I said, and if the roof comes in, I'll preach your funeral. He said, are you serious? I said, I am serious. I don't believe the roof will fall in. I think that you're challenged, and you think if you stay away from church that God can't touch you. But God can touch you no matter where you're at. He can convict you no matter where you're at. Well, when this fella came in, the talk was all among the older people in the church. It spread up. Then you could tell, look who's here, look who's here. Look. And heads were turning. They didn't want to be obvious about it, but they were kind of looking over their shoulder. And I could tell something big had happened. Well, through the service, I watched the individual. He was really broken until the invitation came. When the invitation came, he just got a blank stare on his face. Didn't move, didn't do anything. No one saved that night. We closed out revival that night. But the church had several steps out on the front porch. You had to climb several steps. And after church was over, I was out on the front porch of the church, and this fella came up to me. And he introduced himself. And I said, oh, do you go to church here? No, sir. He said, it's the first time I've been here since 1958. I said, really? Yes. He said, you know, the last time I was here, your dad was preaching here. He said, I remember. He described the revival. He told me things about the revival. See, you can learn things from a sinner's perspective. They see it different than what the church does. He told me things that I didn't even know happened in that revival. And I'd talked to a number of people. And after a while, he stopped. And he said, I stood on these very steps in 1958. I said, you did? He said, yes, sir, I did. He said, I stood right here. Your dad was standing right where you're standing. I said, really? He said, yeah. He said, your dad in love put his arm around me and said, why don't you give your heart to the Lord and ask the Lord to forgive you of your sin? And he said, that night, it was a clear night, and I looked up to the stars in the heavens. And he said, I made a fist to God. And I said, God, if you never bother me again with conviction, I'll never bother you. I won't harm you, but don't ever come around me. Don't ever deal with me. I never want to hear your voice again. I never want you to touch my heart again. And he looked at me and he said, preacher, I've been diagnosed with a terminal disease. And I'm dying. And he said, to this day, I have never heard the voice of God again like that. And he said, I just thought in my mind, if I could come back here like I did in 1958, that maybe somehow, some way, the Holy Spirit that you all talk about would touch my heart. He said, but I'm afraid. I have rebelled against God. And he said, I don't sense one thing. And I watched that old man hobble his way down those steps. And I watched him die a death without the Lord. When the whole time he thought he could rebel against God. You listen to me. Don't you dare shake your puny little fist in the face of an almighty God. You don't tell God when you're going to get saved, how you're going to do it, when you're going to do it. You don't rebel against God. When you're young, the devil will say, wait, you've got plenty of time. And then when you get old, he'll tell you, you've waited too long. You put it off too late. You need to come. You don't get saved when you walk. You say, preacher, when do you get saved? When you can. And tonight, you can. He rebelled. He thought nobody would ever know. Isn't it something? Two battles he fought with the Syrians. And he knew if I heard from a prophet, I'd know whether to fight. He didn't go into battle till the prophet brought the word of God to him. But now he makes a covenant against the word of God. And he thinks he got by with it. You never get by with it. Along comes one of the sons of the prophets, a prophet himself. He finds a neighbor in this chapter. And he says to the neighbor, smite me. Some, if you translate that Hebrew, it means that the neighbor means another son of the prophet. A preacher went to a prophet. One prophet went to another prophet and said, bust me in the face. He wasn't from Soda County, because he would have. People love talking about one another and fighting with one another. People fight with one another, I feel right at home. And he said, smite me. Made no sense. See, unusual. Isn't that unusual? Don't you think that's strange? Could you imagine me walking up to Mike Blanton tonight and say, hit me as hard as you can? That's strange. I don't care what you say. That's unusual. He refused to do it, and he said, you didn't obey God. Because I obeyed God coming to tell you to do it, you rebelled against God. Immediately a lion comes out and slays him. He goes to the next man, and he says, smite me. You know, God don't have to kill but one or two for things to change real quick. He says, smite me. He let him have it. In fact, he not only let him have it, but you read closely before the verse I read you. He not only smote him, but he wounded him. Still, wouldn't you say that's unusual? How could God be in a preacher getting wounded? What glory could God get out of a prophet being smitten, being wounded? Then he puts ashes on his face, disguises himself, and waits on King Ahab. King Ahab passes by, and he says to the king, see, he's portrayed himself now like he has come out of the battle. It looks like he's been through a battle, and it looks like he got wounded in the battle. And the king wants to pay him tribute, honor for serving in the battle. It got the king of rebellion stopped long enough to speak to him. And he said, where have you come from? He said, I have had a man that was placed under my charge. And he said, if I can refer to the text, but as thy servant, as I was busy here and there, the man got away. The man that was placed in captivity by the king and handed to me to keep a watch on, I got busy here and there, and he got away. I am preaching right now, whether you realize it or not. See, you've got an inner man. That inner man is your enemy. That nature is your enemy. But the king has conquered that nature. And he says, now I've taken that inner man and I've put him under subjection. He's a prisoner. Now I'm putting you as guard over that prisoner. You're just fine as long as you watch the inner man. But when you get busy here and there,
come on.
The inner man will get away.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what happened.
Amen.
The king says, you decided your own judgment. Then he reveals himself to the king. And he said, the Lord gave you the enemy in your hand. And the Lord conquered the enemy. He gave you everything that you needed. But you got busy here and there. That doesn't say that he did worldly things. Doesn't say that he did sinful things. Do you know something? It's possible to be so busy for God you backslide. Doing good things, but they're not God things. Maybe I better let off right there. Yeah, it can happen.
Amen.
You get so busy trying to take care of the world that you forget to take care of yourself. You're kind of like the little girl that her grandpa was watching her one afternoon. He was a preacher. He was studying for his message. And the little girl was at that age that she just couldn't seem to settle down and be quiet. And he thought, I know what I'll do. And he goes and he gets this picture puzzle of the world. And he lays that puzzle, breaks up all the pieces, lays them all out. Said, now listen, honey, you don't come and bother grandpa anymore. Grandpa's studying to preach. You don't come and bother me anymore till you get this puzzle put together. And he sets the child down, and that picture of the world, all the pieces looked alike. And he goes in, sits down in his office. About 5-10 minutes later, here she comes. He said, hey, wait a minute. I thought I told you to put that puzzle together. She said, I'm done. He knew that was an impossibility. He said, there is no way all of those pieces all look alike that it's done. How did you do it? She said, come and look. Went and sure enough, there the world puzzle, every piece in place. And he said, how did you do that? She said, I looked on the box and said, it was a two-sided puzzle. And she said, I turned all the pieces over and said, when you turn all the pieces over, there was a picture of a man. And she said, Grandpa, I found out when you put the man together, the world took care of itself. That's what happens. We get so busy here and there. Not even ungodly things. It can be good things. That's why we can't see revival come today. Everybody's too busy for a revival. Too busy to pray. Too busy to read the Word of God. Too busy to go to church. Too busy to carry a burden. Too busy to help somebody in their time of need. Just busy here and there. And the devil loves that. And he said, now you get the same fate. The Lord, I'll close with this. I never meant to preach this long tonight. The Lord, let's get this right. He conquered every enemy.
Amen.
We get busy here and there. You know, if we're not careful, if we're not careful, we'll get tied up with things more than we get tied up with God.
Amen.
And then we start to lose sight of who God is.
Yeah.
How much power he had. Will you give me just maybe 2 minutes more to tell you what a fellow told me last week? It blessed my soul. We were down in Hayesville, North Carolina. Mike and Deborah was down there. Brian was with me. I was preaching there Monday and Tuesday night. And in the revival, this fella came up. I preached the first night about how to survive a lion's attack. And he came up and he said, hey, if you just have 2 minutes, preacher, I want to tell you something. I said, sure. I'd love to hear it. He said, I moved here from Montana. I said, I lived in Montana. And we moved here. He said, I worked a job and I had a little farm out in Montana. And he said, you talked about the lion. And he said, maybe this will be a blessing to you or to others on down the road. And it sure was a blessing to me. He said, I worked long, 2 or 3 days in a row, and said it was getting about dark, but the animals still needed fed, water. Said, so I had a headlamp that I put on, and I went out to the pen to give them the food they needed. And he said, all of a sudden I get this uneasy feeling. And he said, I turned my head a certain direction, and there were two eyes glaring at me. And I realized it's a mountain lion. And he didn't give it much thought. But he said, I went ahead and worked, tried to make a little noise, and said, I looked, and it was closer. And he thought, that lion is coming toward me. It's stalking me. And he said, so I didn't know what to do. He said, so I had a metal gate, and I jumped up on top of that metal gate, held to the post and rattled that gate. And he said, I started screaming as loud as I could scream. And he said, I looked and the eyes were gone. The lion was gone. And he thought, oh, thank you, Lord. He said, I go ahead and start finishing up the work, feeding the animals. And he said, I get that feeling again. I look and the lion was closer than it had ever been before. And he thought, it worked the first time, I'll try it this time. He jumps up on the gate and he said, I scream as loud as I can, wave my arms, make as much noise as I can. Said, but that lion couches down. Now he's ready to pounce on me. And he said, when all of a sudden, I heard the most horrible, horrible fight that I'd ever heard. He said, what I didn't realize, when I got up, that lion hadn't attacked me yet, didn't know who I was, and he thought, I'm going back for seconds to see if he's really strong enough to take me. He said, but what I didn't realize, when I got on that gate and made that noise and started shouting, said, my best friend out there on the farm was an old dog. And said, that old dog heard me shouting. and said, out of nowhere, my friend tackled the lion and said he beat the living daylights out of the mountain lion. He said, if for no other reason, when the lion attacks us, we need to realize we may not be strong enough to come against him, but we've got a friend. Yeah. It's already sized him up. And he hears when we cry, and he hears when we shout, and he comes to our rescue, and he's there to save us in our time of need. He'll not let you down. And as we come to the close of another week's broadcast, I want to thank you for praying for us. I want to thank you for all the support that you give to this ministry, and I especially appreciate you giving time to come and worship together with us on a regular basis. There's one favor that I ask of you as we leave the air today, and that is if you do not know Christ as your personal Savior, and the Holy Spirit has touched your heart about the way that you have sinned against God, and you know that you need forgiveness of that sin, I hope this will be the day that you'll call upon the name of the Lord, because we know that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. We exist for this purpose, not only to bless the believers as we study the Word of God together, but our first and primary goal is to reach those that do not know Christ as their Savior. I hope you'll ask Him to forgive you of your sin, and repenting of your sins, believe in the work that Jesus has done when He died on the cross and rose from the grave. He's at the right hand of the Father. And you know what? He'll make intercession for you. He'll be your mediator. And for His sake, the Heavenly Father will forgive you of all of your sin. I hope that if you do that today, you'll let us know so we can rejoice together with you. Thank you for joining in this week. And until next week at this same time, may God bless you as our prayer.
Thank you for joining us today on Evangelistic Outreach Ministries.
The fields are white, all ready to harvest.
For more information about this ministry, contact us at Evangelistic Outreach Ministries, 299 Ohio Avenue, New Boston, Ohio, 45662, or toll free at 800-767-8713. You can also visit us online at calvinevans.org.